Hello and welcome back to coverage of Grand Prix Indy. We are in the quarterfinals here. I'm Gabby Sparks, joined by Luis Scott Vargas. And here we see Mason Linne playing Affinity. Over on the left, Team Robots, which seems like a lot of people are on his team. Over on the right, we see Scott Lipp. He's playing Through the Breach. Has a ton of names, but basically Through the Breach, Emrakul, and Primeval Titan.
Yeah, you can call it BreachScape, you can call it Titan Shift, you can call it Valakut. There's a lot of things you can call it. Regardless of what you call it, Valakut the Molten Pinnacle is ultimately the end goal here.
Looks like our players are drawing their opening seven. This is for the quarterfinals.
Oh, one thing that I did not take into account is that Mason actually is a higher seed, so Mason gets to choose whether to play or draw, and by that I mean he gets to choose to play. So,
of course.
So that does give Robots a bit of an edge here.
All right, so he's off to a quick start here. A Mountain into Mox Opal, Memnite, Vault Scourge.
Yeah, Signal Pest is going to give Mason 2 points on turn two. Not a huge amount of power, but next turn it's going to be joined, it looks like, by a Cranioplating. So this could be actually a pretty quick game for Team Robots.
Scott is off to a good start, too, though. The Search of Tomorrow is suspended on turn one. But that Cranioplating coming down, this is a lot of damage, counting the number of artifacts.
That's 7 points of damage between the Cranioplating and the Signal Pest Battlecry trigger. So Scallop's already at 13. It's his turn two. He hasn't even taken a second turn yet.
These foils are too strong for you.
Yeah, that's why I said Team Robots all the way.
All right. Let's see, Scott Lipp on top. Remove one suspend counter off of that. Search for Tomorrow, and he's going to have to string something together quickly here. He will be very dead to these robots if he doesn't find. He has things like Anger of the Gods, but he's at 12 life.
Yeah, Scott needs to find an Anger or a Lightning Bolt very quickly, or that Cranioplating is just going to take giant chunks out of his life total. Unfortunately for Scott, one of Mason's few remaining cards is an Arcbound Ravager, so even an Anger of the Gods is not going to be enough because that Ravager can just live through it.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Sakura Tribe could provide a blocker, except it looks like Mason might. Ooh, Arcbound Ravager? Yes, and he's going to move that Cranial Plating over to the Signal Pest, which cannot be blocked here. Sakura Tribe Elder getting in front of the Memnite, sacrificing to search a land out of Scott's deck.
And that's 6 more points, essentially flying. Signal Pest, yeah, like you said, it only can be blocked by flyers. And we're seeing a little bit of a shortcut here. Scott wants to resolve both his search effects at once.
Scott deciding which land he wants to get out of his deck. He's going for another Mountain.
You know, if Scott has land Through the Breach, that could be kind of interesting. A turn three Through the Breach into Emrakul could put up a good fight here. As BreachScape, Titan Shift, Valakut is under a lot of pressure from that Cranioplating. Turn two Cranioplating equip on the play. I mean, that's why you play Affinity. It just draws like this.
Let's take a look. Big draw set for Scott. He does not an Anger of the Gods, and he does not have one in hand either.
No, and thanks to that Ravager, Mason's even pretty resilient to Anger. He just has a draw that covers most of the angles. Scott could Summoner's Pact and play an Obstinate Baleth here, it looks like, but he doesn't have 6 mana for a Primeval Titan. It's not even clear Primeval Titan would be enough. And Obstinate Baleth might buy him a turn, but then he has to pay for the Summoner's Pact. So the card Scott's missing is Elvish Spirit Guide, which is not legal in this format because he could Summoner's Pact for it in order to play a Titan here on turn three. But that's not a card I expect to be reprinted anytime soon. Yeah, because remember, because of Scott's Search for Mara and Scourge Tribe Elder, it looks like he is going to go for that Obstinate Baleth play.
Okay, so it looks like Summoner's Pact will get that Obstinate Baleth back in hand. Going to gain him some life. He does have a land he can fetch. He's going to get second green here for that Obstinate Baleth.
So I think Scott was basically hoping to draw either Simeon Spirit Guide or Through the Breach this turn to combo with that Primeval Titan. He drew neither and is kind of forced to play a Desperation Obstinate Baleth here. The last time we saw him Summoner's Pact for Obstinate Baleth, he was response to Liliana. This time, don't think it's going to work out quite as well.
So Obstinate Baleth coming down for Scott. And things are still looking pretty grim. It's going to see a draw set from Mason. It is a Blink Moth Nexus.
So Mason has 7 artifacts in play. So Signal Pest deals 7. both the Ravager and the Memnite deal two, even without anything else, because of Signal Pest's Battle Cry. So unless Scott has Lightning Bolt in his hand, which we can see that he doesn't, it's going to be hard for him to survive this. And even a Lightning Bolt, the Ravager might be able to play around it.
Scott counting up the number of artifacts to see how big this cranial plating can be. Blink Moth Nexus can now be activated to also increase the artifact count. Looks like that Baloth might be getting in front of that Arcbound Ravager.
And again, Memnite's a 2-1 right now, thanks to Signal Pest's ability. So as long as Mason activates Blink Moth Nexus, he can deal 9 damage here.
So he's counting it up. Number of artifacts, animate Blink Moth Nexus. This is 9. Scott, what do you have? Counting it up again just to double check.
Scott, verifying these edits. It's good to run the numbers just to make sure, but it does look like enough damage.
Did the math, and it's true. Mason Linne takes the first game here, Affinity versus BreachScape. That was a blisteringly fast start for Mason.
Yeah, that was about a 4-minute game, which is given shuffling is about as fast as you get, you know, something along those lines.
Here we see Mason with his foiled out. I saw when we asked earlier which team people wanted to be on, some people voted for Team Foil.
Yes, Team Foil.
So taking a look at the player's sideboard, Luis, what do you think they can do moving into game 2? Obviously, first game 1 is going to be very fast, but game 2, which will presumably be a little bit slower, what can Mason do?
Mason's got Thoughtseize and Stubborn Denial, which are both somewhat disruptive against a deck like Through the Breach. Both can Thoughtseize can take any of the cards Scott's relying on, and then Stubborn Denial can counter Through the Breach effectively. Other than that, there's not a whole lot that I'm very impressed with out of this sideboard for this matchup. I think Mason's just going to try to race Scott. Maybe he takes out the Etch Champions for those two cards, something along those lines.
All right, and taking a look at Scott Lipp's BreachScape deck.
And Scott has a little bit more action. He's got Engineered Explosives, Ancient Grudge, Anger of the Gods, and Reclamation Sage. So he's got a lot of options here, and he can try to speed up his deck a little bit. Maybe something like Scape Shift is just too slow. Corsair of Crucifix, just incremental value cards might not be where he wants to be. Obstinate Baleth, for example, doesn't impact much against Affinity, whereas Ancient Grudge is quite good.
What do you think about like slower cards such as Crumble to Dust?
It's funny because I've actually boarded Crumble to Dust against something like Infect to take out their Nexus, but against Affinity, you just can't afford to do that. Mm-hmm. So I would not expect to see Scott boarding in Crumble to Dust here.
And so because this is the top 8, the players have access to each other's deck list, which makes sideboarding a little bit more interesting. They can kind of try to next level each other and figure out, well, this person's going to board this way, which means that maybe I'm inclined to take out my Simian Spirit Guides or something like that. So the players will have a little bit of time to take a look at each other's deck list and decide how they want to approach the matchup.
Yeah, and top 8 lists also help even out the fact that a lot of these players have been, you know, playing on camera throughout the course of the event. So in general, I think as long as it does not slow down the tournament too much, I like having top 8 lists. Having perfect information makes a lot of sense, and the players can sideboard with that in mind.
Oh, it adds a nice level of complexity to it, too. I think being able to know, you know, there are no more question marks. A lot of times when you play against someone, you can guess, right? You guess, I think they're playing this, especially with something like the BreachScape deck. You could guess, oh, maybe they don't have Scape Shift. Maybe they do have Scape Shift. Maybe they have Emrakul. Maybe they don't. So having full information will actually let them play an even better game of Magic.
You see Scott Lipp getting the final look. And you can't look at the deck list during the games, but in between games it is permissible. It's going to be on the play here and maybe try to assemble like a turn 3 or 4 Through the Breach. He got pretty close last game. He was missing just one key component, either a Through the Breach or a Simian Spirit Guide. And had he had one of those cards, he could have actually had a Primeval Titan in play on turn 3. The one thing we're missing from this overlay is we're not noting which cards are foil, but I believe Mason has his entire deck foiled out, but we need to actually verify that every single sideboard card's foiled out because, you know, for completeness sake.
For completeness sake. Otherwise, why would you get on team foil?
Yeah, I mean, you can't be team foil unless you have, like, all foil deck.
It's kind of flavorful that it's all foiled out and this is also a robots deck.
Yeah, that's true.
It.
Robots
nice
are,
and
are,
nice
are
metallic,
shinier.
Shiny. Yes. Quarterfinals. Who will win? Let us know on Twitter. You can vote on the Twitter poll. Looks like 60% of people think that Scott Lipp is going to win, but currently Mason Linne is up a game.
Well, Mason's certainly the favorite, being up a game, as it turns out. But you know, there's still plenty of Magic to be played, and both these decks are capable of explosive draws. You know, if Mason's draw was a touch slower, Scott might have been able to pull it out. He had a turn four Primeval Titan. Mm-hmm. That's generally a pretty good start.
Modern's of turn four format, that seems like a very reasonable time window and time frame to kill your opponent. But yes, Mason was off to a very fast start.
And I think that this top eight is going to be a pretty fast one. Just these the decks we're looking at are quite fast. Mason Linne up a game here.
Players still shuffling up, moving into game two. We'll be bringing you updates of what's going on in the other quarterfinal matches as well.
Kind of curious where that blue-white Delver deck with Commandeer and Geist of St. Traft and Disrupting Soul finished up.
Well, the good thing is that hopefully if it finished well enough, there will actually be a deck list printed for it.
Right, something that Frank Karsten, who's on text coverage, brought up. The top 64 deck lists will be posted online after the event if you go to Daily MTG and the events page, as Frank and Mark Calder are diligently typing up all those deck lists.
So if you want to take a mono blue Delver to your local shop, that is something that you can do. It looked sweet from the, we didn't get to see it that much, but from the one match that we got to see, it was a very cool deck.
Frank Karsten ran the numbers, and 64 was the right number of deck lists to display. Had right. to be a power of two, of course.
Frank Karsten being our local friendly number runner.
Yes.
What was the number that he recently ran for you? The likelihood that you would top eight three Pro Tours in a row?
Yeah, I think he got it wrong, though, because the percentage was 0.15%, which sounds low given that it occurred. Because if that number is correct, that means I got incredibly lucky.
That would just never happen, correct?
Right, and that's clearly not the case. Is that three Mox Opals in Mason's hand?
I think it is.
Wow, we might see a sweet hand, because Mox Opals do chain into each other kind of nicely. Oh, there's a Memnite.
Oh, there's a Memnite.
That had to be great.
Oh, so Memnite, Glimmer Void. Yeah, Vault Scourge, Mox Opal.
Oh, my
gosh. Tap it for mana.
This
play
is a
another
turn
one.
Master of Aetherium.
Tap it for mana.
Oh,
play
no,
a Steel Overseer.
Okay, he's running the Steel Overseer turn one. But
wow.
I think he had the option of playing turn one Master. The Steel Overseer actually seems better to do, but it is pretty awesome that was one of the lines Mason could have.
That was insane. I mean, this is why you play Affinity. Left in hand is another Mox Opal and a Master of Aetherium.
I'd certainly foil out my Affinity deck if it treated me this well.
Well, so it looks like that Memnite was a great draw on turn one, too, especially with it does change it, right? This is a better reason to play Steel Overseer on, too.
Oh, for sure.
Stomping ground for Scott Lipp. Let's see.
He's got a Reclamation Sage, but he didn't count on seeing a turn one Steel Overseer, followed by a turn two Master.
Usually you hope you have a little bit of time to kill that Steel Overseer. Looks like the best thing he can do here is a Farseek.
And that's not bad. Turn two Farseek, turn three Reclamation Sage on the play is generally a hand that I think has competitive against Affinity. So we'll see how much pressure Mason can put on Scott here, but it looks very good from Mason's side. He actually drew a Thoughtseize here, so if he wanted to, he could have run Thoughtseize, but he's just going to go for broke.
Yeah, he has played out all his cards at this point. I mean, he has one left, but he is going to use that third Mox Opal as just a Lotus Petal. Counters on all of his creatures, and in come Vault Scourge and Memnite. This drops Scott down to 15. All right, he's putting him in a spot. Do you have it, Scott?
Well, he came over for six there, so we'll see how the life totals end up. But I think Scott should be a few points lower, because remember the Master of Theorem does give all your other artifact creatures +1 as well. So what would happen if Scott had Anger here? Would that even? I mean, I would kill Steel Overseer. I guess it would. No, it would kill everything. Anger would be great. But let's hope Mason is not tempting fate here and angering the gods.
Well, I think at some point you put your opponent on, do you have it or not? And I think that's what he's doing right here. Like he's going for broke. And, I mean, he's going to finish this game in a second if he doesn't have anger. And Scott doesn't.
No, Scott's got the Reclamation Sage.
I think Mason can breathe for a second there when that happened. Actually, Lightning Bolt to take down that Steel Overseer is pretty good.
Wow, that was actually a great turn for Scott. It actually puts Scott into pretty decent shape. Looks like we've got the life total updated here. But Scott now... he's kind of stabilized. The Vault Scourge is still coming in for two. The Memnite can at best trade for the Reclamation Sage. And Scott has handled Mason's incredibly fast draw quite well.
Mason is able to take the Primeval Titan from Scott's hand with a Thoughtseize, though, and that was the last meaningful card in Scott's hand. So Scott, right now, with only one land in hand.
Well, the good thing for Scott, though, is he does have a Valakut, so he's only a couple lands away from just drawing a bunch of free Lightning Bolts, so it's possible that if Scott draws spells, he might draw like a Titan or another artifact removal spells, and if he draws lands, he might be able to kill that Vault Scourge with Valakut sooner rather than later.
Blink Moth Nexus is the land for this turn for Mason. We're going to see a pass back to Scott. Another mountain getting closer without Valakut. All right, so Scott going to tutor any green creature out of his deck, and he's going to choose Primeval Titan. That Summoner's Pact is looking very good.
And now with five mountains already in play, he can get a Valakut and another mountain and immediately get two Valakut triggers.
Wow. And this incredibly fast start for Mason is falling apart as that Primeval Titan takes care of the very last robot.
So even though Scott has to pay for a Summoner's Pack next turn, that Primeval Titan attacking will lead to four more Valakut triggers, and that's going to be very difficult for Mason to survive.
It looks like Blink Moth Nexus is getting in, and that's all that Mason's going to do. His draw was an Ink Moth Nexus, which is also down on the battlefield now. Scott remembering to pay for his pact, double checking that he's paying the correct colors.
Seems pretty smart to pay for your pact in this situation, or in basically any situation. I guess unless you have Angel's Grace. And Scott, he also has two lands in hand, so he can get like Valakut. If he gets Valakut in a mountain, he does three triggers now. If he just gets two Valakuts, he does four triggers now, plus two, six Valakut triggers, plus the Primeval Titan. That's 24 damage right there. I think we're going to see a game three after two insanely fast
starts.
There
it is. Those were two insanely fast games, but Scott Lipp takes this game, pushing it to a game three. You can see him breathing a sigh of relief right there. It looked like he wasn't going to be able to come back. That was such an incredibly fast start for Mason.
Yeah, both players in that game had incredibly good draws. In fact, you know, Scott had a great draw in game one as well. So we've seen the battle of great draws, and the player on the play win both games so far. Luckily for Mason, you know, here in his Affinity deck, he gets to be on the play for game three.
What was really impressive, too, is that it seemed like there was one window where he needed Anger of the Gods to actually clear out all of Mason's robots, but being able to go Reclamation Sage into Lightning Bolt, like, that was good enough.
Yeah. Rexage plus Lightning Bolt, killing Master of Ethereum, killing Steel Overseer, providing a blocker. Scott actually stabilized with that sequence of plays.
Well, moving into game three, Mason gets to choose to be on the play. How relevant do you think that's going to be here?
Given how fast these decks are, I mean, again, the fewer the number of turns in a given game, the more important being on a play is, because it just accounts for such a larger percentage of, you know, the game. And in this particular case, these decks are both, well, they don't normally goldfish this fast, I don't think, but both these decks are showing these like incredibly fast draws. So we'll see if Mason is able to convert his being on the play. Scott may try to break serve here. I mean, if he draws Simeon Spirit Guide or Ancient Grudge, those are like two cards that can get him out from behind on the draw. But a normal hand of like Through the Breach into Titan on turn four appears to not be fast enough.
It's funny that we had this game where Mox Opal was incredibly busted.
Yeah.
Because one of the things that you were talking about earlier in the tournament, one of the factor fictions is whether or not it would be appropriate to ban Mox Opal. And I think we both ended up on the side of we should not. But in that game, we actually got to see how powerful it really is.
Yeah, I'm still fine with Mox Opal existing in this format. But games like that, they do make me a little suspicious. Mason had access to four mana on turn one.
Yes.
I mean, you don't normally draw three Mox Opals, but still quite powerful. Imagine if Mason had drawn an Arcbound Ravager so he could eat the Mox Opals instead of having to just sacrifice them to the Legend Rule. That would have been interesting. Someone asked if there are any Merfolks in Day 2. Yeah, Merfolk did in fact make an appearance on Day 2, though none in the top 8, as you see. So you could scour the top 64, potentially.
Yeah, the modern metagame is pretty diverse. So there, you can pretty much, you'll be able to take a look on Daily MTG and see the metagame breakdown there. But pretty much almost all the decks that you expect would make it onto day two. So thankfully, we see a little bit of diversity there.
Scott, on the right there, a member of Team East West Bowl, he played all the Pro Tours last year, and in fact, recently had acquired a number of GP top eights. He's just adding to the mix here, so a good start to the season. Win or lose here, making a GP top eight at one of the first GPs of the season is a great way to start, the 2016-2017 season off.
We've got an update from one of our other quarterfinal matches. Rob Pisano wins against Ryan Solov 2-0.
Another update that the commentators for this match are Gabby Sparks and Luis Scott Vargas.
Well, thank you for the update. That was very useful.
It was a timely update, just to make sure we knew where we're at in the tournament.
All right. Well, where we are in the tournament is the quarterfinals, moving into game three, and Mason Linne gets to be on the play.
Can I point out, by the way, that this match has been insanely fast and another match already finished?
Yes, you can definitely point that out.
This is a matchup where Mulligan aggressively definitely helps. These games have lasted somewhere between 4 and 5 turns, and given that, seeing a fresh 6 cards if your hand doesn't have what it takes is important.
All right, so Glimmer Void, Springleaf Drum. Mason start not as fast as last games.
Scott's hand looks quite good. He's got Search for Morrow. He's got Sakura Tribe Elder. He's got Simeon Spirit Guide. He even has Anger of Gods. Does he have the turn on Ancient Grudge?
Oh, my God. And he's going to destroy that Glimmer Void in the process, too. Mason Linne loses both. And Mason Linne misses a land drop. Wow, you were talking about Ancient Grudge being good here, but it couldn't have been better. The Glimmer Void has to be sacrificed at the end of the turn if Mason doesn't have another artifact. And now Scott has a Search for Tomorrow. No lands. Pass back to Scott. And this might be over very soon.
When I said that a Simeon Spirit Guide and Ancient Grudge were key to speeding your deck up, I didn't mean both on turn one, but I guess that's how Scott wanted to play this game, and it worked out very well for him.
Memnite, which he can play without any mana, but it's just a 1-1. On the other side, Scott is going to take the Search for Tomorrow off a suspend, getting another land from his deck, and Sakura Tribe Elder also there on the ready.
If you ever played Magic Online, it used to be that if you only had a 1 non-land permanent in play, like that Memnite, it would just be gigantic, filling the whole screen. And as it turns out, that Memnite's filling Mason's whole screen here, since that's all he has in play. He doesn't have a land. He kept a 1-lander with Springleaf Drum. Makes a lot of sense. Scott had the turn 1 Ancient Grudge, which is not a play I think I've ever seen.
All right, so Scott deciding how he wants to sequence this. It is Bin Savage. Getting close to those 5 mountains for Valakut. Sakura Tribe Elder getting in, no fear.
Getting aggro Sakura Tribe Elder, and I think Scott would trade Sakura Tribe Elder for Memnite because it just makes Mason's future draws so much worse.
Okay, so Mason does find a land. Another Springleaf Drum. Vault Scourge using that Memnite to tap for mana. But Mason is far behind now.
So Scott doesn't actually have a lot of action in his hand. It looks like he's got the 2 Anger of the Gods, but there's no kill condition there. This is where Valakut actually starts grinding out the opponent. Scott has essentially 5 mountains in play if you count that Bloodstained Mire, which means that when he plays Wooded Foothills, that triggers Valakut. Scott's in a position where almost every card in his deck deals damage. Lands deal damage. Spells almost end the game, like if he draws a Summoner's Pact or a Primeval Titan. There are just very few dead draws that he has. Even like a Sakura Tribe Elder, it essentially comes with a free Lightning Bolt.
Anger the Gods to take out the last 2 creatures. A Wooded Foothills. 2 more mana. Sakura Tribe Elder pass back to Mason. And this Valakut is now online. Looks like Memnite for Mason. An Arcbound Ravager. And pass back. And here we go, Scott.
Scott also has that Ancient Grudge in the graveyard here. Is he deciding whether he wants to respond to the Ravager? Looks like he might be.
Looks like he's sacrificing the Sakura Tribe Elder. Another mountain enters the battlefield.
So that's Scott's fifth mountain. So either of those fetch lands, the Bloodstained Mire or the Wooded Foothills, will trigger Valakut if Scott chooses to get a mountain off them.
Looks like he isn't sacrificing them quite just yet, but Valakut is now online. 3 mana. A second Anger of the Gods. Yep, away they go.
So Scott's options right now, he's got two Valakut triggers with lands in play. He's got a mountain in hand that he can play to trigger Valakut, and he's got an Ancient Grudge in his graveyard. So it's going to be a long time before Mason can really seriously threaten Scott, and Scott has a ton of cards in his deck that if he draws them, he wins basically on the spot.
All right, Scott's going to draw. Looks like it's a Through the Breach.
We're actually starting to get to the point where Scott has to count how many mountains are in his deck. He's got six basic mountains, so he can search out two more because he's got one in his hand. So Sakurachai Builder and Search for Tomorrow, they're not an infinite resource. They eventually will run out.
Well, that one mountain does take down the Vault Scourge. Mason has a full grip of hands, but no way to deploy any of these threats. Scott playing another mountain, passing. Darksteel Citadel, another land for Mason. Mason is staring at this saying, what can I do? How do I get out of the situation?
And the best Mason can do is just play creatures, but that's just going to be so hard in the face of an active Valakut. Uh-oh, that looks like a Primeval Titan. This game may be drawing to its natural conclusion.
Four mana, 5/6. Down comes Primeval Titan. Bam. Trigger.
And now
two lands.
Yeah, now Scott can just fetch out two Valakuts, and then each of those fetch lands represents 9 damage, and the land in Scott's hand represents 9 damage.
All right, so two Valakut, the Molten Pinnacle. Sacrifice the first Bloodstained Mire. Keep searching, and three Valakut triggers about to go on the stack.
And Scott won this game on turn one with that Ancient Grudge, Simian Spirit
yes.
Guide play.
It's been a long game considering what happened, but it was won in that first turn for sure. Bloodstained Mire getting the second mountain. Three more Valakut triggers, and that should do it. And there's a handshake. Scott Lipp takes this and moves on to the semifinals. Well, you can see he's smiling. Feeling pretty happy moving on to the next round. Awesome start to his year.
Yeah, and that was a pretty fast match. I mean, that game three lasted about as long as the first two games put together, but it was still, I think, in a lot of ways concluded when Mason didn't play a land or permanent on turn two. That tends not to be a great sign.